Israel is itself a startup. And we think that's very relevant and critical to the whole story in explaining why we're so good at startups. And part of that is that we are a country of immigrants. And it's very important to understand that, they're basically, as far as we can tell, only two countries in the world that are both innovative and entrepreneurial. There are countries, there are a lot of places that are very innovative, you know, like Finland, Singapore, Korea, you know, a lot of bright people, a lot of patents. You know, if you measure innovation by patents, you know, we're way up there, but so are a lot of other countries. So the question is, why in all these countries where you have lots of patents, you don't have lots of startups? And the reason is, because if you're, you know, a smart guy producing patents in Finland, you probably go into Nokia. Or if you're doing that in Korea, you go into Samsung. But if you're in Israel, you do a startup. And that's a big difference. Because we have these kind of entrepreneurial juices along with the innovative juices. And the combination is what's producing all these startups. But what part of what makes us innovative is that we are a country of immigrants. Because if you pick up yourself and move to another country, you're a risk taker. And you need to be a risk taker to be an entrepreneur. So immigrants are natural entrepreneurs. And we are not only a country that, you know, we're all first, second, third generation immigrants, basically. But we're also the most pro-immigration country. We're probably the only country where politicians actually campaign promising that they're going to bring more immigrants to the country. You know, in America or almost anywhere else, if they're going to campaign about immigration, it's going to be that they're bringing less, not more. The kind of the big families that are centralized, you know, own so much in the economy and okay. Well, the way that works is there's basically, unfortunately, there's sort of two economies in Israel. There's kind of the high tech and there's everything else. And the high tech is performing, is the engine of the economy. Without the high tech, our economy would not be in good shape. Our non-high tech economy is basically underperforming compared to many other countries in the world if you just take the high tech out. And it's because, we would argue, though we don't get into a lot in the book, and I want to, if there's a Hebrew edition someday, I hope there is, and maybe we'll add a whole section on this, because I feel very strongly that the Israeli economy could grow much faster if the conditions, that the positive conditions in terms of taxes and regulations that apply to high tech were applied to the rest of the economy. And for some reason, the different governments in Israel have understood that you have to be good to high tech. And in fact, it's very, you know, relatively easy and potentially lucrative to start a high tech company. But it's much harder to open a restaurant or do anything in the rest of the economy because of the lack of competition, because of the high, you know, taxes are too high, because of too many regulations. So the question is, why don't we treat the rest of the economy as nicely and smartly as we do the high tech economy? And if we did, we'd all be a lot better off. And also, this gets to the question that I often ask about the gaps. I mean, between that kind of the high-tech boom has caused. That's the way to address the gaps. I mean, without high-tech, our economy would be nowhere. If you look like a graph of Israeli exports, it's basically, you got one line that's oranges kind of going along like this. And then you got high tech kicking in, going like that. And so without the high tech, all you have is oranges, basically. So it's not, the solution isn't to get rid of high tech. The solution is to help the rest of the economy come up the way high tech has.
You're talking about the both immigration, which is sort of political motivated, like politicians saying we're going to bring more immigrants, and in general the assistance that the government gives to the startup nation. And, or maybe I'm just not seeing it because I'm inside, but seeing other countries really motivate new startups by giving them a big grant just for starting up things, tax deductions in the beginning of their activity. I don't see that really in Israel, and the same for immigration. I do see politicians claiming they're going to bring immigration here, but most of the effectiveness of immigrants here is not government motivated, but more of a, as you said, like it's a country of immigrants. So it's more a thing rather than the government. How do you see the government involvement here?
Okay, well. I would say that the most important thing the government did by far, and probably the most successful and brilliant thing I almost say the government has ever done, is the Yozma program, which was in the 90s when it started this kind of partnership between Israeli VCs, some seed money from the government, and foreign VCs all together partnered and giving the VCs an upside. It basically jump-started the whole venture capitalism industry from nothing. You know, as we say in the book, before Yozma is like rock and roll before Elvis or something. It was just, there was nothing. Though it's not fair to certain VCs who were here before this. But basically, that was the story, and it was the government that jump-started the venture capital industry and deserves incredible credit for that, and also for getting out. I mean, for doing a successful program and then selling out to the private VCs. So this was a perfect thing of getting in, getting out, and you very rarely see government do that. But the other stuff, like chief scientist grants and all, I'm not such a huge believer in that. I think the most important thing government can do is kind of get out of the way in terms of taxes and regulation and not be a burden on the system, and you know, if you can jumpstart things the way Yozma did, great, when there was no venture capital industry, but you kind of, it's hard for the government to pick, you know, to pick startups better than, say, venture capitalists or whatever. If you can't attract commercial money, you know, there's a limit to what the government can do to really help, so.
Okay, we have time for one more question. Back.
Ezra Katz, following up on what you just said, I came here a few years before you, I'm here since 89. And the time that I got here, there was a chief scientist, and there was a food enterprise. It was a couple of years later, but right around the same period of time. Everything I know about the Israeli economy from the 1980s, especially the disaster that happened here in the mid-80s,
right. That's
an utterly inexplicable situation. I haven't been here 20 years, I can't explain how all those pieces of the puzzle were in place in that environment.
You mean why it fell apart in the 80s or why it was fixed?
Who thought and the vision to put all these pieces of the puzzle in place so that when the Russian immigration came, everything would just take off?
Yeah, well, it was kind of a classic example of kind of solution by crisis. I mean, the economy practically fell apart. As you know, the hyperinflation of the 80s, say 85 times, it was the 85 stabilization plan, which was Shimon Peres and George Shultz in the United States and people like that, which was triggered by the hyperinflation that basically was the watershed between the old economy that, you know, the totally socialist, almost anti-free market, anti-entrepreneurial economy, and the economy of today. That was the watershed. It didn't happen instantly, but that was the beginning of the government kind of, you know, lowering taxes and reducing regulation, more privatization, and so on, which was absolutely necessary because that whole system that had done so well for 20 years hit a wall. There was a limit to how much you could do with top-down economy. It worked for the beginning of the state when you were starting from nothing, but it didn't work, and it hit a wall eventually as the economy grew, and that was the tepher, you know, the watershed between the old and the new.
Okay, Saul Singer, thank you very, very much.
Okay, by the way, can I add one for your next book, another theory? So, when you spend, for your next book about the Startup Nation Part 2,
yeah.
When you spend 3 years in the Army and then you spend another year getting high in India, it's really hard to come back and get a real job. And so we have to do this. just a serious note before we part. Thank you for coming to speak, and you know, we'll pass it on to Dan as well. It's doing a real practical service to everybody in this room, because more startups in this room will get funded because the world is seeing a different side of Israel, and we thank you for that. Thank you very much. Okay, unfortunately, I know I promised you we were going to announce like open positions and things like that. We do not have time. We are we're all out of it, but we have pizza left, I think, and water. It's kind of cold and nasty, but the point of meeting is getting to know each other. There are investors here. There are, everybody here is a founder, and we just had the Zelle Entrepreneurship students join us. Woo-hoo! Thank you, guys. Thank you, IDC, for hosting us. Liat, Maya, thank you very, very much. See you next month.